And satirist immortalised by a roundabout, Hogarth's Progress.
Hogarth has been called the father of British art. But the man with the scar on his forehead and the defiant look in his eyes was a lot more turbulent and contradictory than that neat little phrase suggests. Hogarth wasn't just the most famous image maker of the 18th century. He was one of those rare artists who managed to define their world, to picture its desires and its fears. He was the first British artist to see, really to see, the people who subsist at the ragged margins of urban life, and he changed society's view of itself forever. Hogarth left his mark all over London, but the passage of time has covered over many of the tracks. This is the house in Chiswick that he bought in 1748, towards the end of his life. No amount of English heritage Georgian green paint can hide the fact that it's not quite the place it once was. He bought this rather grand house as a second home, a quiet retreat. In his time, it was at least an hour away by coach and four from the busy hubbub of the town.
The best known monument to Hogarth today is probably the Hogarth Roundabout, which is about 200 yards down there. It seems a fairly dubious honour. After all, who'd want to be memorialised by the junction of the M4, M3 approach roads? But in Hogarth's case, it seems peculiarly appropriate. After all, his best known works, The Rake's Progress and The Harlot's Progress, are journeys through London. Shabby old London was his muse, and the chief subject of Hogarth's art was how people get on, or fail to, in the merry-go-round of the city.
His own life was a kind of journey through the many different worlds and underworlds of his hometown. He was born in 1697, deep in the heart of the city.
Progress began in Smithfield, which was then, as it still is, London's main meat market. In Hogarth's time, it was a much smellier, noisier, bloodier place than it is today. Animals were slaughtered as well as sold here, and the waters of the nearby Fleet Ditch were often choked with offal. It's difficult to know what effect all this had on Hogarth, but it certainly didn't put him off his food. He was a founder member of the Sublime Society of Beefsteaks, and he's the only artist I can think of to have painted a picture in praise of the traditional British Sunday roast.
When mighty roast beef was the Englishman's food, it ennobled our veins and enriched our blood.
What's that cut?
That's a loin. They come from the bottom end. See the bottom end of it? That's what that is. With the flank on. They haven't taken the flank off of that.
English roast beef. But since we have learned from all neighbouring...
That's the trouble in the nerves going off their back. Yeah, that's right, yeah. English beef.
Never knows ya.
Beef was once a nationally recognised symbol of British liberty, and Hogarth's famous picture, The Roast Beef of Old England, is a kind of hooligan chant in oil on canvas.
You have
dare I say it, the whole BSE crisis in this picture. Here you have the Fra feeling the beef. Here are these, you know, insipid Frenchmen dribbling their thin broth. And right in the middle of it is this great representation of beef. And I can just imagine him going on about how all these continentals are looking horrified at beef, which is, of course, what they do now. And all because some few people with some German-named illness have died. It's just ridiculous. Speak for beef, speak for England.
It's the satirist's job to cut us down to size, to remind us that we all end up as dead meat, on the slab, like the outraged cadaver of the convicted criminal in The Reward of Cruelty.
It's a wonderfully cruel image. I mean, it is almost defining the kind of Hogarthian ethos that there is reward and punishment in it. He's not an amoral or objective commentator. He's saying this is what will happen to you. It's almost like a cannibal feast, which is that recognition of those aspects of humanity which we try to forget about, like what's inside a human being, what happens when you strip away the flesh of a human being.
Close to Smithfield was Grub Street, an area infested by hack writers. And Hogarth's father was one of them. Men desperately feeding a new appetite for printed matter, to be read and discussed in the print shops and coffee houses of the time. Hogarth's father was a failed classics teacher who spent his life showing his son how not to get on in 18th century London. He was forever dreaming up crackpot schemes, the most naive of which was the Latin-speaking coffee house, which he opened here in Smithfield in 1703. Gratias tibi. Known necesse est dicere, rem omnem de fecisse, known solum hogarthos rationes conturbavisse, sed etiam hogarthum maiorum in vincular conjectum esse. Hogarth's father spent several years in the notorious Fleet prison for debtors. The threat of incarceration always seems to hang over the characters Hogarth invented in later life, as if he never quite got over this episode in his childhood.
At the same time, Hogarth's older brother died, which made him suddenly not only the son of an imprisoned man, but the oldest child in the family. And even at 10 or 12, I think he would have had to go out to work then to help them. So there's a great sense of all that energy and vivacity of childhood suddenly disappears, and you feel that all the way through his work too. You see things suddenly collapsing. Like pits opening beneath you, houses falling. And part of that, I think, comes from his childhood. So whereas his childhood gave him a great sympathy for the poor, I think it made him absolutely determined, you know, never to be one of them.
A low-cost apprenticeship was negotiated for Hogarth with a silver engraver. But after 6 years, he set up on his own, engraving on copper. He worked from his mother's house in Long Lane, Smithfield, supplying the market for trade cards, labels, and book illustrations. He found a lot of the work arduous and dull, but at least he was in a business that was booming.
London was a city that was completely abuzz in the early 18th century. It was expanding in size and in numbers. It had a cosmopolitan air to it. There were thousands upon thousands of immigrants and refugees coming in from the continent. It had become, in many ways, the sort of news and commerce centre of the world. What was going on in London was a sort of media revolution. There were lots of people who were concerned with picking up information, disseminating it. This is the age when newspapers first start coming in, political prints and other prints begin to appear, the theatre is thriving. London is a place where everybody is talking, reading, seeing, watching, listening all the time. Hogarth was very much part of that.
His problem always is there's plenty of work for engravers, it seems, but the key thing is to become independent, to break out of just simply working for others. And I think that the key thing is that satire became a way for him to do that.
Hogarth decided to take his chance in this new, swiftly developing market. He gave up trade work and started designing and selling his own satirical prints. There was certainly no shortage of targets in a feverishly expanding London, where corruption was rife and where, on fortune's fast-turning wheel, for every poor loser like Hogarth's father, there could be found an equally undeserving winner.
Hogarth disliked the way in which London was being swamped by foreign tastes, and one of his great bêtes noires was William Kent, the artist, designer and toady to the great. And he does a print called The Taste of the Town, in which he wants to suggest that Kent is nothing more than a kind of exterior decorator.
William Kent was famous for promoting classical Italianate art and architecture, with the support of some extremely powerful patrons. He was a dangerous enemy to make. Hogarth depicted Kent as a statue perched ludicrously on the classical pediment of a misspelt academy, while, in the foreground, the masses are flooding to see vacuous foreign operas and spectacles, ignoring the good old-fashioned fare of Congreve, Dryden and Shakespeare, which is carted away as waste paper.
One of the things about Hogarth is that he had this tremendously strong sense of Britishness as against the continent. It was a time when Britain had been fighting the continent, so there was a very heightened awareness of what it was to be French or German or Italian. He was confronted by what he regarded as his enemies, who were lovers of all things French and Italian. They brought back Italian clothes, Italian styles, Italian houses, Italian architects, Italian food. He detested it all.
Hogarth always found it easy enough to know what he hated, but less easy to know what to embrace. He wanted to be able to propose a true blue British alternative to foreign taste. But at this early stage of his life, he wasn't quite sure what that might be. Nobody was. There was really no such thing as a distinctively British school of painting when Hogarth was a young man. He liked to claim that the streets of London had been his academy. The folklore about Hogarth has him making thumbnail sketches, literally on his own thumbnail, of his observations of urban life. And as he said in some autobiographical notes, I endeavoured a habit of retaining whatever I saw in such a manner, thus strolling about, my studies and my pleasures going hand in hand.
During the early part of his career, Hogarth's studio became known as a place where there was generally something interesting to be seen. He certainly painted some erotic pictures, or scenes of gallantry as they were called. One painting in particular, a sketch of a prostitute getting dressed, would, in a roundabout way, come to make him famous.
The picture itself is sadly lost, but the narrative series of prints which Hogarth developed from it does survive. In A Harlot's Progress, Hogarth set out to tell a shockingly contemporary tale of life in the big city. The tale itself is not complicated. A young girl, Moll Hackabout, comes to London, falls into prostitution, succumbs to syphilis and dies. End of story. But Hogarth spiced this sad cycle of events with a mass of intricate detail and a multitude of topical references to characters in the news. Within weeks, more than 1,000 copies had been sold, and eventually every man, woman and child in London would know the story of The Harlot's Progress. Hogarth was the very first British artist to reach a mass market in this way.
Hogarth knew perfectly well what he was doing, I think. He's perfectly well aware of the seductive effect of depicting the life of a harlot. But he's also very careful not to step over certain bounds and to keep the morality there as well. But I don't think that meant that Hogarth was cynical. I think he's just simply, you know, aware of the difficulties of being moralizing. It is based on an ancient idea that you achieve instruction through delight.
Then be not coy, but use your time, and while it may go merry, for having lost but one. that's your prime, you may forever tarry.
I think even he must have been stunned at the success. I don't think he expected anything like this kind of success. But what it does do, it gives you a strong sense of Hogarth, who's a sort of chancer. He's always sort of saying, well, let's see if this works. If that doesn't work, he'll try that. And he's very fluid, very mobile, and he's always looking for opportunities, always restless and trying to find a way of making money, but also increasing his standing in the world.
London in the early morning of May 27th, 1732. Five men, all of them drunk, are leaving the Bedford Arms Tavern in Covent Garden. They are much too happy to go to bed, but what else can they do?
The euphoria of Hogarth's first big success was dramatised in a television programme made in 1971 by another satirical artist, Gerald Scarfe.
Although I'd made a little bits of films before, I'd never done a full film, and I was flattered by the idea of being a director with actors and so forth. I was thought to be in the Hogarthian line at that time in the 60s and 70s, because up until that point there hadn't really been much attacking caricature or much attacking cartooning of any type.
The peregrination, as it's known, is a wonderful episode in Hogarth's life because it's about the only time she's absolutely written down what happened. What it was a holiday, a jaunt with four friends. All around them, aspiring young painters were off to Italy to study, and grand aristocrats and their patrons were off on grand tours around the continent. And somebody in this circle had a very bright idea that they should go on their own grand tour to North Kent. So North Kent replaced the whole of Europe, and they behaved as antiquarians. They visited the dockyards and they wrote down epitaphs in churchyards, and they inspected the gunnery and things like that. They also ate enormous meals, and they also fooled around a tremendous lot. So a lot of the description, which is afterwards written down, is concerns dung fights and water fights and ludicrous episodes in inns. And then they agreed to write it down and do their drawings, and they bound it in leather and they stamped it with History of Kent, or Tour of Kent Vol 1, as if there were many more vols to come, which never did come.
This little book contains what's really our only glimpse of the private Hogarth. It also gives us a pretty good glimpse of Hogarth's privates. For example, on page 5, Hogarth having a motion untrust upon a grave rail in an unseemly manner, which, Tottle perceiving, administered penance to the part offending with a bunch of nettles. Hogarth's endpiece is an emblematic self-portrait as a nobody, literally a head with no body. This was how he liked to see himself, a bluff everyman figure, very much in opposition to the somebodies of this world, like William Kent. This is unpretentiousness taken to the point of antagonism. In fact, by this time, he was far from being a nobody. Not only was he the most famous printmaker in Britain, he was also the leader of a vociferous public campaign for artists' rights, the most tangible legacy of which is a roll of vellum in the House of Lords archive. The overnight success of A Harlot's Progress had meant that it was pirated immediately, and Hogarth, who had a genius for business as well as for art, responded by going on to the attack. He persuaded Parliament to change the law. Hogarth's Act, as it came to be known, was the first copyright protection ever established in the field of the visual arts. In winning his own freedom from the pirates and the middlemen, Hogarth had also struck a decisive blow for future generations of British artists. When he was young, Hogarth had come here to Greenwich Naval College to see the most ambitious sequence of narrative pictures ever painted by an Englishman, Sir James Thornhill's vast Baroque allegory of the Protestant succession. He was overwhelmed by them, and above all by the sheer scale and seriousness of Thornhill's endeavour. Here was proof, at least in Hogarth's eyes, of how high an English painter could rise, given the determination and the opportunity. High enough to paint the very grandest subjects, on the largest possible scale, to challenge, if not quite defeat, the great masters of European art, such as Michelangelo, Raphael, and Rubens. Hogarth never forgot the experience of seeing these pictures, and he later said that they were always in his mind's eye, tormenting him with the smallness of his own work as a printmaker. Thornhill was the artist that he desperately wanted to be, and when Hogarth wanted something, he always went after it. In 1724, he'd signed up at Thornhill's Art Academy. Then he'd got to know Thornhill's daughter Jane. They'd eloped and got married in secret. Hogarth had managed to turn his father figure into his father-in-law.
There's no description of their courtship. There's simply an announcement that Mr. Hogarth, the young engraver, has married Jane, the daughter of Sir James Thornhill, against her father's will. And some said that he eloped and so on. So it is peculiar, because it's as if in all the old stories of the apprentice, that's what you do. You marry the master's daughter and you inherit the firm. And it's like a sort of wanting part of the magic, you know, wanting to be part of this family, especially perhaps because his own father was such a disaster.
By the early 1730s, Hogarth and Jane seem to have become reconciled with Thornhill, and they appear in this sketch by him for a formal group portrait of the family. They were now living in Thornhill's elegant house in Covent Garden, and doubtless thanks to his influence, Hogarth got his foot in the door of a rather better class of clientele. He painted a series of group portraits, or conversation pictures, for his new patrons. Hogarth thought of such work as the first rung on the ladder of grand narrative painting, and he introduced intricate narrative details into the stiff world of early Georgian portraiture. Hogarth's originality got him noticed at court, and soon he had high hopes of royal patronage. By the time he painted these aristocratic amateur theatricals, he'd also extracted permission to sketch at a royal wedding at St. James's Palace, or so he thought. He was met at the door by his old enemy, William Kent, the master of ceremonies and, by now, a man of great influence. Kent barred his way, and Hogarth never painted royalty again. In the snakes and ladders game of royal patronage, Hogarth had suddenly slithered all the way back down to square one. But while his pride might have been damaged, I don't think it was necessarily a bad thing for his art. And as so often seems to have been the case in Hogarth's life, as one door closed, another one seemed to open. Hogarth went back to the public that knew and loved him, and the result was the Rake's Progress. As he always did in the case of his most ambitious print series, Hogarth actually began by creating a series of oil paintings. These would be publicly exhibited in his house as a kind of tease, an advertisement for the prints that would later be engraved from them and sold by subscription. The 8 original paintings for the second and most famous of his progresses are now in the Sir John Soane Museum in London.
Soane bought them in 1802, hung them here, as they've been here ever since. It's interesting, though, that when he was alive, he had the Rake's Progress hidden behind panels, as he considered it too distressing a subject to look upon every day. I think the Hogarths had a moral force which is lost on the modern viewer, who tends to notice the caricature element rather than the tragedy. People were genuinely moved by Hogarths, and at the same time as Soane bought them, the keeper of prints and drawings at the British Museum wouldn't show Hogarths to children.
Hogarth meant the Rake to be seen as the male counterpart to his harlot. except in this case, his protagonist began life rather higher up the social scale. Gormless Tom Rakewell is a young gentleman of comfortable means, who sets out to live the life of someone far grander than he actually is. He goes at the town as if he were some dissolute milord, drinking and whoring his way to satiation. But his greatest sin is his emptiness. The rake is a hollow man, playing a part on the stage of his own self-delusion. In a last fatal attempt to sustain that role, he tries to gamble his way to the riches he never had, but no dice. The game's up. And he ends his days in Bedlam, the prison for the insane. The series contains several touches hinting at autobiography. The rake's fortunes take their decisive downward turn when he's arrested near St. James's Palace. And the man on the extreme right, in the shadows in the Fleet, with a crazy scheme to solve the national debt spilling from his pocket, may be a disguised portrait of Hogarth's own father.
It's the rake's progress. We all have the best of aspirations when we start our journey in this world. And sadly, things go awry. Things don't happen as you want them to. And like the rake, many of us go off the rails. Many of us decline. We're fallible. But the whole thing of Hogarth is about human fallibility.
Well, the moral authority that the satirist has is entirely sort of self-appointed. I mean, there isn't any in particular. And the 18th century satirists were a lot more confident in their moral behaviour, in their sort of God-given duty to point these things out, than we are. It would sound very pompous now. I mean, Hogarth was great friends with Alexander Pope, who said that satire was a sacred weapon left for truth's defence. Quite difficult to get away with that now when you're doing cheap jokes about John Major on the cover. And Hogarth's problem was even that when he was doing very straight paintings, about halfway through he just couldn't resist putting jokes in. Or putting in low-life characters on the side whose faces he could push a little bit further towards caricature rather than serious portrait painting. And he was just too good at it, really.
Hogarth's sense of humour and capacity for observation were precisely what crippled him as a would-be creator of high art. The rebuilding of one of London's hospitals, St. Bartholomew's, gave him the chance to try his hand at elevated history painting. The resulting pictures are a well-kept secret now, to all bar the few unsuspecting medical students who sign up for the guided tour.
Hogarth was very keen to become a governor of the hospital, but to become a governor you had to give £50, and he was a little bit short of cash, so he said...
When, in 1734, Hogarth heard that an Italian, Jacopo Amigoni, was negotiating with the governors of Barts to decorate the stairway of their new hospital, he was incensed enough to offer to paint the walls for nothing. As an Englishman, they accepted.
If you look on the left-hand side, starting with the lady who's not at all well, looking very grey, she has iron deficiency anemia, hasn't been eating enough meat and fish and vegetables. The man with the long stick is clearly blind, and looking over his left shoulder is somebody with very yellow sclera to their eyes. That person's clearly suffering from jaundice. And then the other side of Christ, the main person in the picture.
The Pool of Bethesda shows us Christ among the sick, and its grand theme was meant to be the blessedness of the medical vocation. But it's been remembered as a collection of specimens, Dr. Hogarth's casebook.
Myotonia congenita. Now, the lady of obvious ill repute, very naked there, with a rather tender and swollen left knee, thought to be suffering from gonorrhea.
No one can deny that this gallery of evidently ill people is very convincing, even if they are a bit more London than Palestine. But the head of Christ is terribly weak. Hogarth just couldn't do dignity, nobility. He was a painter of people, not gods. Hogarth was brought up a Protestant. I wonder about the extent to which his imagination, so shadowed by intimations of mortality, was shaped in church. Protestantism is essentially a preaching faith, and Hogarth, the deviser of visual sermons engraved in black and white, always was a bit of a tub-thumping preacher. Hogarth was christened here in the Church of St. Bartholomew the Great, and although he was never a conspicuously devout man, I don't think we should underestimate the importance of religion to him. Hogarth the philanthropist is a largely forgotten figure, but throughout his life he devoted a considerable amount of energy to improving the plight of London's homeless children. Hogarth and his wife always remained childless, which may partly explain his close involvement in the setting up of a home for abandoned children, the Foundling Hospital, in what is now Coram Fields. Hogarth's most enduring contribution to the new charity was this brilliant and humane portrait of its founding father, Captain Thomas Coram, which is now recognised as one of the masterpieces of 18th century European art.
For Hogarth, it was his first attempt at a kind of grand manner, full-length portrait, you know, in the Baroque court style, the kind of thing that he, in fact, had consciously avoided doing up to this date. But I think here, at last, he'd found a subject that he thought was worthy of that kind of treatment. Paradoxically, not a great aristocratic landowner, but somebody rather like himself, a kind of self-made professional man who devoted part of his retirement to a very worthy cause, but who had got where he'd got through his own efforts rather than through birth. He's not wearing a wig. Very unusual for a gentleman to be seen publicly without a wig. His long grey hair tumbles around his face, so that the kind of mask that had characterised portrait painting in England prior to this date is well and truly shattered. Hogarth's kind of ruddy face as he paints Coram is a kind of living likeness, very much giving us that notion, as Hogarth put it later in his life, that the face is the index of the mind, he says.
Nevertheless, Hogarth still hadn't achieved his greatest ambition, which was to storm the citadel of high art. The fact is that despite his huge popular success, the people who really mattered, the connoisseurs and tastemakers of the time, continued to look down on Hogarth. So in 1743, he decided to take the form he'd made his own, the Progress, and to bring it up market. Having done female folly and male folly, in Marriage à la Mode, he did both at the same time, telling the story of an ill-starred union between the daughter of a city merchant and the son of a hard-up member of the nobility, strapped for cash because he's thrown his money away on the Italianate folly seen through the window. There is a progress among the progresses, and Hogarth clearly meant Marriage à la Mode to have a rather more elevated tone than its bawdy predecessors. Although the tale itself is the usual grim affair, the settings are consistently more genteel, drawing rooms and morning rooms, not whorehouses and prisons, and the body language is subtler. In this picture, Hogarth really caught the sense of a marriage going wrong. She's yawning flirtatiously, but her husband, the man with the broken sword, is already shagged out. Hogarth tidied up his style too, adopting an elegant Rococo manner which, he hoped, would appeal to the toffs. Even the climax has added class. This anti-hero and anti-heroine weren't allowed to slide into the sewers of low-life London. Instead, Hogarth gave them leading roles in a tragedy of betrayal and death. This could almost be high art, if it weren't for the slight overacting, the smell of grease paint, and the faint but unmistakable insinuation that this is really just a cheap melodrama. In 1745, Hogarth publicly took stock of his position by painting the brilliant self-portrait with Pug. Conservation work has shown just how careful he was when it came to the construction of his own image.
when we x-rayed the painting about 15, 16 years ago, we realised that, like many paintings by Hogarth, it had undergone several significant changes during the course of painting. Very few are quite as dramatic as this one. As you can see from the x-ray here, he'd started off painting himself in a full formal wig, which is painted in very thick white paint. He had a frilly shirt front, also painted in thick paint, a coat with brass buttons, probably a mahl stick here, and certainly a set of brushes, the tools of his trade. At this point, the dog wasn't included. And so the overall picture is that he is portraying himself as a gentleman in formal attire. Then at some point, Hogarth decided on a major alteration. He painted out the wig and the shirt front and the brass buttons and the mahl stick and brushes, put the dog in, and painted himself in a cap and in what painter's working attire, more suitable for his own state of mind, I think.
This is Hogarth at the high point of his career, bristling with self-confidence. With or without the dog, there's no mistaking the character of this proud, pugnacious man.
First and foremost, he was a polemicist. He believed very strongly in certain things. He believed other people should think them too. He had friends and he had enemies. His whole life expressed this antagonism. What's so fascinating about him is that he managed to express this in art. He put his ideas into paint and into prints. And he did so in such a way that we still love them today. I mean, there were plenty of polemicists right back through history whose words, whose pictures, whose images now really are dead. We look at them and we think, well, that was interesting in the 15th century or the 17th century or whatever. The thing I find about Hogarth is that you look at his pictures and you see in them all kinds of morals and messages which are highly relevant today.
In the mid-18th century, we know that of the 2,000 houses in this neighbourhood, about one in four were so-called tuppenny houses, drinking dens where the poorest of London's poor came to anaesthetise themselves in cheap and noxious booze. Murders, muggings, rapes and suicides were daily events here. And one day, a crazed alcoholic called Judith Dufour strangled her two-year-old daughter just to sell the child's clothes for the price of a drink. The story is said to have inspired Hogarth's most famous image, Gin Lane.
What draws you into Gin Lane is obviously the central image of this drunken woman dropping her child because she's so drunk. And from that you go out to these wonderful crowd scenes of drunkenness and debauchery and degeneracy, and there's this scene of the honest workman, the carpenter, who's pawning his saw because it's the tool of his trade, but he's giving that up because he's so obsessed with gin. Then you start noticing things in the background, like this body being either interred or disinterred, you can't quite tell. And somebody in a wheelbarrow, some kind of cripple, being fed gin, a baby being fed gin by her mother. This starving man with his rather alluring-looking dog. And it turns, in a way, into a kind of defining image of metropolitan decay. That, you know, you're half in love with this, but you're also repulsed by it. And for me, it's always been a very useful kind of stock image to conjure up that idea of the total urban collapse of society.
Lots of people in the 18th century had very clear political allegiances, and Hogarth wasn't one of them. He can't be pinned down as being a Whig or a Tory, and his satire is against everybody. I mean, there's a great deal of satire against judges and bishops and the establishment, but political radicals as well, like John Wilkes, the leader of the mobs and the riots in the 1760s, he is also satirised as well. I think that's partly in the manner of a satirist. All satirists ought to be even-handed against everybody. It's a bit like Private Eye these days. I mean, if there's a Tory government, it will satirise the Tories. If there's a Labour government, it will satirise Labour. And Hogarth was in that sort of tradition, I think.
Just come across that way. Sorry.
In 1754, Hogarth delivered his non-party political broadcast in the form of a series of pictures called The Election. That's quite nice.
with Hogarth, you always get one sort of overall joke, and then hundreds of little details. And here, this rather revolting banquet is a parody of The Last Supper. So you've got that as the sort of main joke, and then you just start looking at how politics is operating here. These are the Whigs stuffing themselves there, and out the window you can see the Tories. The Tories have got a no Jews banner. They're sort of playing the race card fairly early in this election. The Whigs here, their banner is liberty and loyalty, and the Tories out the window says liberty and property. Quite difficult to tell the two parties apart. That's another of Hogarth's more modern messages. But here they are. This bloke has to kiss this terrible old crone, and someone knocks his pipe out on the candidate's head. He has to pretend he's enjoying that. It's all very funny. And they're two complete drunks who've come in off the street, and the other candidate has to pretend that he's interested in their opinions, which of course he isn't. And then there's all the stock Hogarth men, a fat clergyman stuffing champagne and roast something in. And then the local mayor, who's a very important figure, has just had a surfeit of oysters, and he's being bled here. He may actually be dead already, no one really knows. This is the man I really like. He's the election agent, same figure then and now. And he's got a book of sure votes and doubtful votes. And because he's got no one who's definite, because you never know, and a whole load of doubtfuls. But the Tories have chucked a brick through the window. She just whacked him on the head there, and the brick's flying off there. And the joke, apart from the fact it's quite funny that an election agent is hit by a brick, the joke is that this is a parody of the conversion of St. Paul in a well-known painting. So the only way you're going to convert this particular Whig to the Tory cause is to throw a brick at him. It's quite a good joke, really.
Hogarth may not have been a party political creature, but towards the end of his life, he was certainly a man with a manifesto. In 1753, he published a treatise called The Analysis of Beauty, which was yet another attempt by this restless man to take on the sort of highfalutin project which no one else thought he was suited to.
Hogarth's theory of beauty was based on his own highly original reading of human psychology. Pursuing, he wrote, is the business of our lives. The love of pursuit is deeply implanted in our natures. It was certainly deeply implanted in his nature. From there, he went on to argue that this applies to our very way of seeing, that we can't help loving forms which, in his words, lead the eye a wanton kind of chase. For Hogarth, the most beautiful forms were always curvy, and his favourite illustration of this was the well-laced stay.
Hogarth's term for the S-curve described by a woman's bodice was the serpentine line, seen here in its perfect form in figure 4. The analysis certainly gives the lie to the received view of Hogarth as an invariably grim, moralising artist. His aesthetic pronouncements are so relaxed, so sensual. Admittedly, he didn't put them into practice very often, but when he did, as in this portrait of the ever-so-slightly wanton-looking Mrs. des Aguliers, the results were memorable. With the publication of The Analysis of Beauty, Hogarth had definitely entered the downward cycle of his own progress. His book was not praised, but mocked, and he was increasingly regarded as an eccentric, anachronistic figure by a new generation of artists. Joshua Reynolds, the rising star of British painting and the future founder of the Royal Academy, described his works as vulgar and limited. And Hogarth, the great satirist, was himself viciously satirised.
Paul Sandby, better known today for his mild and pleasant watercolours, published these savage caricatures of Hogarth in December 1753. Sandby's Hogarth is a pretentious, fat, ugly little man, a fairground con artist, desperately trying to gull the public with his quack cure-all, the serpentine line. Hogarth was deeply wounded by the attack. He was never really the same man ever again.
When there begins to be this move against him and this feeling that his art isn't really serious enough or or that there are things that he can't aspire to, he becomes extremely tetchy about it. He tries to justify what he does ever more stridently.
Hogarth made one late attempt to rehabilitate himself. He persuaded Richard Grosvenor, an aristocrat sympathetic to his cause, to commission a history painting from him, on a slightly grisly theme from the Italian poet Boccaccio's Decameron, Sigismunda mourning over the heart of her lover Guiscardo. The project misfired badly.
Sir Richard Grosvenor was disgusted by the picture and refused to accept it. He told Hogarth that he couldn't bear the idea of having it in his house, even if it was kept behind curtains. The story goes that a later owner even rented it out as an example of how not to paint in the grand manner.
I don't think the picture's nearly as bad as it's been made out to be. In its melancholic way, it's one of the better English history paintings of its time. Although that may partly be because Hogarth toned it down after Grosvenor refused it, painting out the blood that originally dripped from Sigismunda's fingers. Like a strange, sardonic afterthought, he also included himself as this sad little gargoyle on the table leg.
This is a print called The Cockpit, which Hogarth made towards the end of his life. And it's one of the most terrifying prints, I think. This is the blind gambler, Lord Albemarle Bertie, who is betting on the cocks while being unable to see them. And at the time Hogarth made this, he saw fanaticism and cruelty and hysterical self-interest all around him. And in this picture, everybody is alone. They're all part of a crowd, and they're at a communal event. But everybody is isolated. Everybody is touching. Everybody is being put upon by other people. But they're absolutely all driven by their own obsession. Gambling, which Hogarth often painted, was like a sort of fever of aspiration. And this print sums it all up. And to me, knowing that Hogarth was making it at a time when he himself was deeply disturbed. It's as if also he has gambled everything. He has been the man who placed his bets, who wanted to do it, and perhaps he too has been blind. And this terrible thing about an artist who sees so acutely being also blind to what's happening around him.
I suppose there was a slight whiff of the Rake's Progress, and there is in all of our lives. We never quite accomplish what we hope to accomplish, I believe most of us. And whatever you do accomplish, you always feel you could have accomplished more.
Hogarth painted this portrait of his servants late in life. It's such a neutral, but somehow democratic painting. He just presents these people. Here they are. As if to remind us that ordinary men and women are worth remembering too. He hasn't even bothered with the composition, just filled the canvas with these beautifully observed heads. One last blow struck for the nobody. It's a shame that Hogarth couldn't let himself be the way he let these people be. Hogarth died in 1764. His progress, which had been remarkable for a man of such unpromising origins, ended here in Chiswick, where he's buried. He'd dreamed of becoming painter to the king, but he'd become painter to a whole city, London's artist. Despite all his success, he never could quite bring himself to believe that it was enough simply to be William Hogarth. But it was.
opening beneath you, houses falling. And part of that, I think, comes from his childhood. So whereas his childhood gave him a great sympathy for the poor, I think it made him absolutely determined, you know, never to be one of them.
A low-cost apprenticeship was negotiated for Hogarth with a silver engraver. But after 6 years, he set up on his own, engraving on copper. He worked from his mother's house in Long Lane, Smithfield, supplying the market for trade cards, labels, and book illustrations. He found a lot of the work arduous and dull, but at least he was in a business that was booming.
London was a city that was completely abuzz in the early 18th century. It was expanding in size and in numbers. It had a cosmopolitan air to it. There were thousands upon thousands of immigrants and refugees coming in from the continent. It had become, in many ways, the sort of news and commerce centre of the world. What was going on in London was a sort of media revolution. There were lots of people who were concerned with picking up information, disseminating it. This is the age when newspapers first start coming in, political prints and other prints begin to appear, the theatre is thriving. London is a place where everybody is talking, reading, seeing, watching, listening all the time. Hogarth was very much part of that.
His problem always is that there's plenty of work for engravers, it seems, but the key thing is to become independent, to break out of just simply working for others. And I think that the key thing is that satire became a way for him to do that.
Hogarth decided to take his chance in this new, swiftly developing market. He gave up trade work and started designing and selling his own satirical prints. There was certainly no shortage of targets in a feverishly expanding London, where corruption was rife and where, on fortune's fast-turning wheel, for every poor loser like Hogarth's father, there could be found an equally undeserving winner.
Hogarth disliked the way in which London was being swamped by foreign tastes, and one of his great bêtes noires was William Kent, the artist, designer and toady to the great. And he does a print called The Taste of the Town, in which he wants to suggest that Kent is nothing more than a kind of exterior decorator.
William Kent was famous for promoting classical Italianate art and architecture, with the support of some extremely powerful patrons. He was a dangerous enemy to
his own efforts rather than through birth. He's not wearing a wig. Very unusual for a gentleman to be seen publicly without a wig. His long grey hair tumbles around his face, so that the kind of mask that had characterised portrait painting in England prior to this date is well and truly shattered. Hogarth's kind of ruddy face as he paints Coram is a kind of living likeness, very much giving us that notion, as Hogarth put it later in his life, that the face is the index of the mind, he says.
Nevertheless, Hogarth still hadn't achieved his greatest ambition, which was to storm the citadel of high art. The fact is that despite his huge popular success, the people who really mattered, the connoisseurs and tastemakers of the time, continued to look down on Hogarth. So in 1743, he decided to take the form he'd made his own, the Progress, and to bring it up market. Having done Female Folly and Male Folly, in Marriage à la Mode, he did both at the same time, telling the story of an ill-starred union between the daughter of a city merchant and the son of a hard-up member of the nobility, strapped for cash because he's thrown his money away on the Italianate folly seen through the window. There is a progress among the progresses, and Hogarth clearly meant Marriage à la Mode to have a rather more elevated tone than its bawdy predecessors. Although the tale itself is the usual grim affair, the settings are consistently more genteel, drawing rooms and morning rooms, not whorehouses and prisons, and the body language is subtler. In this picture, Hogarth really caught the sense of a marriage going wrong. She's yawning flirtatiously, but her husband, the man with the broken sword, is already shagged out. Hogarth tidied up his style too, adopting an elegant Rococo manner which, he hoped, would appeal to the toffs. Even the climax has added class. This anti-hero and anti-heroine weren't allowed to slide into the sewers of low-life London. Instead, Hogarth gave them leading roles in a tragedy of betrayal and death. This could almost be high art, if it weren't for the slight overacting, the smell of grease paint, and the faint but unmistakable insinuation that this is really just a cheap melodrama.
One of the most terrifying prints, I think. This is the blind gambler, Lord Albemarle Bertie, who is betting on the cocks while being unable to see them. And at the time Hogarth made this, he saw fanaticism and cruelty and hysterical self-interest all around him. And in this picture, everybody is alone. They're all part of a crowd, and they're at a communal event. But everybody is isolated. Everybody is touching. Everybody is being put upon by other people. But they're absolutely all driven by their own obsession. Gambling, which Hogarth often painted, was like a sort of fever of aspiration. And this print sums it all up. And to me, knowing that Hogarth was making it at a time when he himself was deeply disturbed, it's as if also he has gambled everything. He has been the man who placed his bets, who wanted to do it, and perhaps he too has been blind. And this terrible thing about an artist who sees so acutely being also blind to what's happening around him.
I suppose there was a slight whiff of the Rake's Progress, and there is in all of our lives. We never quite accomplish what we hope to accomplish, I believe most of us. And whatever you do accomplish, you always feel you could have accomplished more.
Hogarth painted this portrait of his servants late in life. It's such a neutral, but somehow democratic painting. He just presents these people. Here they are, as if to remind us that ordinary men and women are worth remembering too. He hasn't even bothered with the composition, just filled the canvas with these beautifully observed heads. One last blow struck for the nobody. It's a shame that Hogarth couldn't let himself be the way he let these people be. Hogarth died in 1764. His progress, which had been remarkable for a man of such unpromising origins, ended here in Chiswick, where he's buried. He'd dreamed of becoming painter to the king, but he'd become painter to a whole city, London's artist. Despite all his success, he never could quite bring himself to believe that it was enough simply to be William Hogarth. But it was.
He's just simply, you know, aware of the difficulties of being moralising. It is based on an ancient idea that you achieve instruction through delight.
Envy not coy, but use your time, and while it may, go merry. For having lost but once your prime, you may forever.
I think even he must have been stunned at the success. I don't think he expected anything like this kind of success. But what it does do, it gives you a strong sense of Hogarth, who's a sort of chancer. He's always sort of saying, well, let's see if this works. If that doesn't work, he'll try that. And he's very fluid, very mobile, and he's always looking for opportunities, always restless and trying to find a way of making money, but also increasing his standing in the world.
London in the early morning of May 27th, 1732. Five men, all of them drunk, are leaving the Bedford Arms Tavern in Covent Garden. They are much too happy to go to bed, but what else can they do?
The euphoria of Hogarth's first big success was dramatised in a television programme made in 1971 by another satirical artist, Gerald Scarfe.
Although I'd made little bits of films before, I'd never done a full film, and I was flattered by the idea of being a director with actors and so forth. I was thought to be in the Hogarthian line at that time in the 60s and 70s, because up until that point, there hadn't really been much attacking caricature or much attacking cartooning of any type.
The peregrination, as it's known, is a wonderful episode in Hogarth's life because it's about the only time she's absolutely written down what happened. What it was a holiday, a jaunt with four friends. All around them, aspiring young painters were off to Italy to study, and grand aristocrats and their patrons were off on grand tours around the continent. And somebody in this circle had a very bright idea that they should go on their own grand tour to North Kent. So North Kent replaced the whole of Europe, and they behaved as antiquarians. They visited the dockyards and they wrote down epitaphs in churchyards, and they inspected the gunnery and things like that. They also ate enormous meals, and they also fooled around a tremendous lot. So a lot of the description, which is afterwards written down, concerns dung fights and water fights and ludicrous episodes in inns.
Of Lord's Archive. The overnight success of A Harlot's Progress had meant that it was pirated immediately, and Hogarth, who had a genius for business as well as for art, responded by going on to the attack. He persuaded Parliament to change the law. Hogarth's Act, as it came to be known, was the first copyright protection ever established in the field of the visual arts. In winning his own freedom from the pirates and the middlemen, Hogarth had also struck a decisive blow for future generations of British artists. When he was young, Hogarth had come here to Greenwich Naval College to see the most ambitious sequence of narrative pictures ever painted by an Englishman, Sir James Thornhill's vast Baroque allegory of the Protestant succession. He was overwhelmed by them, and above all by the sheer scale and seriousness of Thornhill's endeavour. Here was proof, at least in Hogarth's eyes, of how high an English painter could rise, given the determination and the opportunity. High enough to paint the very grandest subjects, on the largest possible scale, to challenge, if not quite defeat, the great masters of European art, such as Michelangelo, Raphael, and Rubens. Hogarth never forgot the experience of seeing these pictures, and he later said that they were always in his mind's eye, tormenting him with the smallness of his own work as a printmaker. Thornhill was the artist that he desperately wanted to be, and when Hogarth wanted something, he always went after it. In 1724, he'd signed up at Thornhill's Art Academy. Then he'd got to know Thornhill's daughter Jane. They'd eloped and got married in secret. Hogarth had managed to turn his father figure into his father-in-law.
There's no description of their courtship. There's simply an announcement that Mr. Hogarth, the young engraver, has married Jane, the daughter of Sir James Thornhill, against her father's will. And some said that he eloped and so on. So it is peculiar, because it's as if in all the old stories of the apprentice, that's what you do. You marry the master's daughter and you inherit the firm. And it's like a sort of wanting part of the magic, you know, wanting to be part of this family, especially perhaps because his own father was such a disaster.
By the early 1730s, Hogarth and Jane seem to have become reconciled with Thornhill, and they appear in this sketch by him for a formal group portrait of the family.
Circle had a very bright idea that they should go on their own grand tour to North Kent. So North Kent replaced the whole of Europe, and they behaved as antiquarians. They visited the dockyards, and they wrote down epitaphs in churchyards, and they inspected the gunnery and things like that. They also ate enormous meals, and they also fooled around a tremendous lot. So a lot of the description, which is afterwards written down, is concerns dung fights and water fights and ludicrous episodes in inns. And then they agreed to write it down and do their drawings, and they bound it in leather and they stamped it with History of Kent, or Tour of Kent Vol 1, as if there were many more vols to come, which never did come.
This little book contains what's really our only glimpse of the private Hogarth. It also gives us a pretty good glimpse of Hogarth's privates. For example, on page 5, Hogarth having a motion untrussed upon a grave rail in an unseemly manner, which, Tottle perceiving, administered penance to the part offending with a bunch of nettles. Hogarth's endpiece is an emblematic self-portrait as a nobody, literally a head with no body. This was how he liked to see himself, a bluff everyman figure, very much in opposition to the somebodies of this world, like William Kent. This is unpretentiousness taken to the point of antagonism. In fact, by this time, he was far from being a nobody. Not only was he the most famous printmaker in Britain, he was also the leader of a vociferous public campaign for artists' rights, the most tangible legacy of which is a roll of vellum in the House of Lords archive. The overnight success of A Harlot's Progress had meant that it was pirated immediately, and Hogarth, who had a genius for business as well as for art, responded by going on to the attack. He persuaded Parliament to change the law. Hogarth's Act, as it came to be known, was the first copyright protection ever established in the field of the visual arts. In winning his own freedom from the pirates and the middlemen, Hogarth had also struck a decisive blow for future generations of British artists. When he was young, Hogarth had come here to Greenwich Naval College to see the most ambitious sequence of narrative pictures ever painted by an Englishman, Sir James Thornhill's vast Baroque allegory of the
man with his rather alluring-looking dog. And it turns, in a way, into a kind of defining image of metropolitan decay. That, you know, you're half in love with this, but you're also repulsed by it. And for me, it's always been a very useful kind of stock image to conjure up that idea of the total urban collapse of society.
Lots of people in the 18th century had very clear political allegiances, and Hogarth wasn't one of them. He can't be pinned down as being a Whig or a Tory, and his satire is against everybody. I mean, there's a great deal of satire against judges and bishops and the establishment, but political radicals as well, like John Wilkes, the leader of the mobs and the riots in the 1760s, he is also satirized as well. I think that's partly in the manner of a satirist. All satirists ought to be even-handed against everybody. It's a bit like Private Eye these days. I mean, if there's a Tory government, it will satirise the Tories. If there's Labour government, it will satirise Labour. And Hogarth was in that sort of tradition, I think.
Just come across that way. Sorry.
In 1754, Hogarth delivered his non-party political broadcast in the form of a series of pictures called The Election.
With Hogarth, you always get one sort of overall joke and then hundreds of little details. And here, this rather revolting banquet is a parody of the Last Supper. So you've got that as the sort of main joke. And then you just start looking at how politics is operating here. These are the Whigs stuffing themselves there. And out the window, you can see the Tories. The Tories have got a no Jews banner. They're sort of playing the race card fairly early in this election. The Whigs here, their banner is liberty and loyalty, and the Tories out the window says liberty and property. Quite difficult to tell the two parties apart. That's another of Hogarth's more modern messages. But here they are. This bloke has to kiss this terrible old crone, and someone knocks his pipe out on the candidate's head. He has to pretend he's enjoying that. It's all very funny. And they're two complete drunks who've come in off the street, and the other candidate has to pretend that he's interested in their opinions, which, of course, he isn't. And then there's all the stock Hogarth men, as a fat clergyman stuffing champagne and roast something in. And then the local mayor, who's a very important figure, has just had a surfeit of oysters, and he's being bled here. He may actually be dead already, no one really knows. This is the man I really like. He's the election agent, same figure then and now, and he's got a book of sure votes and doubtful votes, because he's got no one.
Belt Academy. While, in the foreground, the masses are flooding to see vacuous foreign operas and spectacles, ignoring the good old-fashioned fare of Congreve, Dryden and Shakespeare, which is carted away as waste paper.
One of the things about Hogarth is that he had this tremendously strong sense of Britishness as against the continent. It was a time when Britain had been fighting the continent, so there was a very heightened awareness of what it was to be French or German or Italian. He was confronted by what he regarded as his enemies, who were lovers of all things French and Italian. They brought back Italian clothes, Italian styles, Italian houses, Italian architects, Italian food. He detested it all.
Hogarth always found it easy enough to know what he hated, but less easy to know what to embrace. He wanted to be able to propose a true blue British alternative to foreign taste. But at this early stage of his life, he wasn't quite sure what that might be. Nobody was. There was really no such thing as a distinctively British school of painting when Hogarth was a young man. He liked to claim that the streets of London had been his academy. The folklore about Hogarth has him making thumbnail sketches, literally on his own thumbnail, of his observations of urban life. And as he said in some autobiographical notes, I endeavoured a habit of retaining whatever I saw in such a manner, thus strolling about, my studies and my pleasures going hand in hand. During the early part of his career, Hogarth's studio became known as a place where there was generally something interesting to be seen. He certainly painted some erotic pictures, or scenes of gallantry as they were called. One painting in particular, a sketch of a prostitute getting dressed, would, in a roundabout way, come to make him famous. The picture itself is sadly lost, but the narrative series of prints which Hogarth developed from it does survive. In A Harlot's Progress, Hogarth set out to tell a shockingly contemporary tale of life in the big city. The tale itself is not complicated. A young girl, Moll Hackabout, comes to London, falls into prostitution, succumbs to syphilis and dies. End of story. But Hogarth spiced this sad cycle of events with a mass of intricate detail and a multitude of topical references to characters in the news. Within weeks, more than 1,000 copies had been sold, and eventually every man, woman and child in London would know the story of The Harlot's Progress. Hogarth was the very first British artist to reach a mass market in this way.
Hogarth knew perfectly well what he was doing, I think. He's perfectly well aware of the seductive effect of depicting the life of a harlot. But he's...
Hogarth left his mark all over London, but the passage of time has covered over many of the tracks. This is the house in Chiswick that he bought in 1748, towards the end of his life. No amount of English heritage Georgian green paint can hide the fact that it's not quite the place it once was. He bought this rather grand house as a second home, a quiet retreat. In his time, it was at least an hour away by coach and four, from the busy hubbub of the town.
The best known monument to Hogarth today is probably the Hogarth Roundabout, which is about 200 yards down there. It seems a fairly dubious honour. After all, who'd want to be memorialised by the junction of the M4, M3 approach roads? But in Hogarth's case, it seems peculiarly appropriate. After all, his best-known works, The Rake's Progress and The Harlot's Progress, are journeys through London. Shabby old London was his muse, and the chief subject of Hogarth's art was how people get on, or fail to, in the merry-go-round of the city.
His own life was a kind of journey through the many different worlds and underworlds of his hometown. He was born in 1697, deep in the heart of the city.
Hogarth's progress began in Smithfield, which was then, as it still is, London's main meat market. In Hogarth's time, it was a much smellier, noisier, bloodier place than it is today. Animals were slaughtered as well as sold here, and the waters of the nearby Fleet Ditch were often choked with offal. It's difficult to know what effect all this had on Hogarth, but it certainly didn't put him off his food. He was a founder member of the Sublime Society of Beefsteaks, and he's the only artist I can think of to have painted a picture in praise of the traditional British Sunday roast.
When mighty roast beef was the Englishman's food, it ennobled our veins and enriched our blood.
What's the cut? What's that cut?
What's the cut? That's the loin. They come from the bottom end. See the bottom end of it? That's what that is. With the flank on. They haven't taken the flank off of that.
English roast beef. Since we have learned from all
bakery. That's the trouble in the nerves off their pen. Yeah.
The kind of Hogarthian ethos that there is reward and punishment in it. He's not an amoral or objective commentator. He's saying this is what will happen to you. It's almost like a cannibal feast, which is that recognition of those aspects of humanity which we try to forget about, like what's inside a human being. What happens when you strip away the flesh of a human being?
Close to Smithfield was Grub Street, an area infested by hack writers. And Hogarth's father was one of them. Men desperately feeding a new appetite for printed matter, to be read and discussed in the print shops and coffee houses of the time.
Hogarth's father was a failed classics teacher who spent his life showing his son how not to get on in 18th century London. He was forever dreaming up crackpot schemes, the most naive of which was the Latin-speaking coffee house, which he opened here in Smithfield in 1703. Gratias tibi. Non necesse est dicere, rem omnem de fecisse. Non solum Hogarthos rationes conturbavisse. Sed etiam Hogarthum maiorum in Vincular Conjectum Esse.
Hogarth's father spent several years in the notorious Fleet Prison for debtors. The threat of incarceration always seems to hang over the characters Hogarth invented in later life, as if he never quite got over this episode in his childhood.
At the same time, Hogarth's older brother died, which made him suddenly not only the son of an imprisoned man, but the oldest child in the family. And even at 10 or 12, I think he would have had to go out to work then to help them. So there's a great sense of all that energy and vivacity of childhood suddenly disappears. And you feel that all the way through his work too. You see things suddenly collapsing. Like pits opening beneath you, houses falling. And part of that, I think, comes from his childhood. So whereas his childhood gave him a great sympathy for the poor, I think it made him absolutely determined, you know, never to be one of them.
A low-cost apprenticeship was negotiated for Hogarth with a silver engraver. But after 6 years, he set up on his own, engraving on copper. He worked from his mother's house in Long Lane, Smithfield, supplying the market for trade cards, labels, and book illustrations. He found a lot of the work arduous and dull, but at least he was in a business that was booming. Or so he thought. He was met at the door by his old enemy, William Kent, the master of ceremonies and, by now, a man of great influence. Kent barred his way, and Hogarth never painted royalty again.
In the snakes and ladders game of royal patronage, Hogarth had suddenly slithered all the way back down to square one. But while his pride might have been damaged, I don't think it was necessarily a bad thing for his art. And as so often seems to have been the case in Hogarth's life, as one door closed, another one seemed to open.
Hogarth went back to the public that knew and loved him, and the result was The Rake's Progress. As he always did in the case of his most ambitious print series, Hogarth actually began by creating a series of oil paintings. These would be publicly exhibited in his house as a kind of tease, an advertisement for the prints that would later be engraved from them and sold by subscription. The 8 original paintings for the second and most famous of his progresses are now in the Sir John Soane Museum in London.
Soane bought them in 1802, hung them here, as they've been here ever since. It's interesting, though, that when he was alive, he had The Rake's Progress hidden behind panels, as he considered it too distressing a subject to look upon every day. I think the Hogarths had a moral force which is lost on the modern viewer, who tends to notice the caricature element rather than the tragedy. People were genuinely moved by Hogarths, and at the same time as Soane bought them, the keeper of prints and drawings at the British Museum wouldn't show Hogarths to children.
Hogarth meant The Rake to be seen as the male counterpart to his harlot. Except in this case, his protagonist began life rather higher up the social scale. Gormless Tom Rakewell is a young gentleman of comfortable means, who sets out to live the life of someone far grander than he actually is. He goes at the town as if he were some dissolute milord, drinking and whoring his way to satiation. But his greatest sin is his emptiness. The Rake is a hollow man, playing a part on the stage of his own self-delusion. In a last fatal attempt to sustain that role, he tries to gamble his way to the riches he never had, but no dice, the game's up. And he ends his days in Bedlam, the prison for the insane.